I may be well ahead of the curve on this one, but that's what artists do. They set the terms. Visually and grammatically. Welcome to my morning routine. Only you have no idea what time it is. Welcome to my morning routine. Only you have no idea what time it is. What the light was like. That's ambient light. How to see a work of art in total darkness. Diving back into my research practice. I came across a great interview with Simone Lee by Rizvana Bradley. Apologies, Rizvana, if I'm pronouncing your name wrong. I'm gonna have to look up a YouTube video. Autoethnography was one point that Simone Lee, say her name. Understands her practice in part as autoethnography. Which was a really helpful term. Because I myself have been thinking about the affordances of autoethnography. My own work, right? Autoethnography instead of authorship. When I said in my RISD application, which I still have to send off, that I now work with a studio approach, this is the studio approach. I'm generating my own ideas through practice. And yes, I'm talking about other people's ideas, of course, because one doesn't exist in a vacuum. Except for particles. Intentionally created vacuums, like, I don't know, the Hadron Collider. I could be wrong in some of these facts, but the general tape is correct. Autoethnography instead of authorship.
Documenting oneself. Documenting one's self is autoethnography. Writing about other people is authorship. Right? And I was really bummed out about Twitter's, copy merging with Instagram because it's all just monoculture. It's all just monoculture, which is to say that everything's becoming the same. And that's precisely the problem. Unmixing Sadia Abbas, right? She's absolutely correct on that. And I've been working through. Her own invitations, that is to say, not her own, her invitations to her students to think through these ideas as well. And again, because I've set up things in such a way that, like, my Twitter is only active on this account because I have my second iPhone, which is supposed to just be my work or iPhone or my preserve, where like nobody bothers me, except that iOS is on both phones. So even though I've never used that telephone function, in fact, I didn't even have the text messages like on my on my screen, not even my home screen at the bottom. I didn't have it anywhere else. And then I realized that I hadn't paid the bill for that phone because they were sending me text messages and I never saw the text messages. Like, don't understand. And then I'm also feeling concerned for a student. But I'm not gonna act on that concern. Because I saw it happen firsthand when people acted on their concern for me. What if we just let people do what they wanted to do? Part of the test here is to see how protected I am as a white man. And it's also a ritual, right? It's 5:06. I'll give you the tea. I've been in bed since 1:30 a.m. It's 5:06 p.m. Because I feel really emotionally overwhelmed. And it's because I didn't, it's so obvious. It's because I didn't record yesterday. Right, I didn't perform yesterday. Right, another piece from the interview, which I'll link to, is, performance as healing. Right? Performance as healing. That's what I've been doing since, I mean, ever since I switched my Instagram, not my Instagram, my Twitter to the Ana Mendieta. Right? If I wanted to, right, and I did that ritual in the bath, Right? That was actually really, really, really transformative for me. You know, and I've been wanting to do more yoga because my emotions are getting tight, and it's because I haven't been doing my own yoga. Like when I listen to those, if I listen to those earlier audio tapes, now I am doing some yoga. This is called Malasana Squat. I'm just trying to remember the names and I can't. And if I take another Modo Yoga class, I can start to take notes. Right, but what's the difference between performance and producing? Mean, the artwork that I want to do is actually just reading the work of other people. Right? Instead of writing about it, I want to perform it. Yeah. It's about left side of the body where I have the historical pain, the historical trauma, right? Gettysburg College is a site of historical trauma, and it's now become site of historical trauma for me personally, right? Think about that at scale. I've been trying to think of a way to get into writing about Gettysburg College. And that's a good way to start to do it, I think. Maybe this is the practice. Maybe the practice is like just get up and talk for an hour. And then go about my day. Ugh. Ugh. Because it's so dark, you actually don't really know, excuse me, what I'm doing, but supposedly 20 minutes have already gone by, which is amazing. What I know is that if I don't do a single other thing today, I've made this tape. And that feels fulfilling. And I'm searching for a different word than productive. And that's the thing, like, I said in my RISD letter to counter the dehumanizing logics of productivity, and that matches with my critique
critique or criticism of the relentless productivity demands of academia in my teaching statement, which, you know, I just made a couple of tweaks to that teaching statement. I don't need to, like, redo the teaching statement. I was thinking about redoing it in terms of starting with or including a studio approach concept . Actually, this would be interesting.
Okay, Google, what's a studio?
Here's a summary from Wikipedia. A studio apartment, also known as a studio flat, a self-contained apartment, efficiency apartment, bedsitter or bachelor apartment, is a small apartment in which the normal functions of a number of rooms, often the living room, bedroom, and kitchen, are combined into a single room.
Okay, Google, what's the studio approach?
On the website serc.carleton.edu, they say, studio teaching is an approach to teaching that can be used to replace the standard lecture approach.
Okay, Google, what's an artist's studio?
According to Wikipedia, a studio is an artist or worker's workroom. Do you want a little more context?
Yes, please.
A studio is an artist or worker's workroom. This can be for the purpose of acting, architecture, painting, pottery, sculpture, origami, woodworking, scrapbooking, photography, graphic design, filmmaking, animation, industrial design, radio or television production, broadcasting, or the making of music.
How would you combine all of those things into one room? Do you see what I did there? How would you combine all of those things into one practice? While keeping each of them distinct. We people tend to think of nighttime as a liminal space, but what if we thought about daytime as a liminal space? Okay, Google, tell me about Sagittarius.
According to Wikipedia, Sagittarius is the ninth astrological sign, which is associated with the constellation Sagittarius and spans 240 to 270 degrees of the zodiac. Under the tropical zodiac, the sun transits this sign between approximately November 23rd and December 21st.
I'm slightly off. I was thinking that Sagittarius season was going to start tomorrow on the 20th, and in fact it starts on Monday, but it goes until the solstice.
Okay, Google, when does Sagittarius season 2020 start?
November 22nd, 2020. On the website womenshealthmag.com, they say, Sagittarius season starts on November 22nd, 2020 and ends December 21st, 2020.
You know who else I know thinks about the solstice a lot? Justin Vivian Bond. An ex-Bond. Another major reference figure for me throughout this practice. 27 minutes. Did I or did I not say that Scorpio season was always difficult for me? And I had been thinking that I was making it through in fine fashion, and now it gets difficult again towards the end. It's not going to be easy for me to put the performance ritual behind me, which is why really it's a daily practice for me at this point. Which is why I might just do it as a wakefulness practice that I do for the first hour upon engaging consciousness fully. I'm also waiting for my living room to warm up. I mean, there is no heat in this apartment that I can see or feel. I thought I was starting to feel some of it, but I don't know. I mean, it might take a while for the building to heat up. I'm on the third floor. And heat rises. And if I can deal with the drafts from those windows, that might warm things up a lot.
No, I'm still here. I'm just thinking. It feels like the middle of the night, but it's only like 5:12. Okay, Google, what time is it?
It's 5:23 p.m.
5:23 p.m. The last time I checked the time, it was before 5:12. 5:12 or so is when last light happened. You might be watching this or engaging rather with this video documentation of a wakefulness routine. Might be wondering, what is he gonna say next? What do I do in the silences? Well, you can be. Which is what I'm doing, I'm just being. I need to send off this application to RISD. I need to upload some things to my website. And the battery power on this phone is amazing still. 36 minutes. I'm counting, not counting.
I kept hitting my alarm. There was a message on the screen in Espanol, por supuesto. Sobre. The routine of my phone. Something about the routine of my phone usage. I didn't actually read it completely, but something about, I want to say it was a message saying, I mean, an Apple message, right? Saying something about the routine, learning the routines of my phone usage so that the battery could be, would be conserved, but I wasn't using it, and I don't know. I mean, I'm reading into, I'm also now remembering that I was having lots of dreams, or rather, maybe one dream that I kept waking up to and going back to sleep to, about UVA. About being a student again. I want to say about all the traumatic experiences I had, but trauma seems to be flattening out as a category of analysis now. Thinking about my usage of category there. Scattergories. Anyway, the point is that people are different. Every day is different. I feel differently. You know, and censoring myself right now. I was also thinking about how sometimes I just feel so alone.
But I was also really upset last night about my ex, because I really miss him.
I don't know why I'm censoring myself, but yes. The student that I'm feeling concern about.
You know, when I met Arthur, I thought it felt like, I didn't think at the time that it was
a spiritual thank you. think the term spiritual, but it felt like I was being seen fully and accepted fully. And that now feels spiritual. To me, and I do think that Arthur gave me my spirituality back in a real way. But then we completely fell apart from each other. And we're completely separated now, except that I feel his spirit all the time. And it's very different with my student, of course, because I don't have that kind of relationship with my student. They're my student, you know? And I'm very boundaried, but I do open myself up to students a lot by sharing about my own experiences. And I also felt like I had a spiritual connection with this particular student, and now it seems that we've completely fallen apart as well. And what I have been trying to emphasize to this student over the past several weeks is that they actually don't know anything about me. You know? Arthur knows everything about me. And of course, that's why I'm thinking about UVA, because you know, this concept of being seen can feel seen by somebody else, but it doesn't mean that that other person is actually seeing them. Yeah. I know that Arthur saw me because we processed and processed and processed. I learned so much from him. I wouldn't be the person I am today were I not with him. That's a fact. And I had developed this performance practice well before I got to Gettysburg. In fact, I had developed the performance practice. If you can go back and listen to the tapes, because again, I was like, nobody's going to believe me. You can go back and listen to the tapes. I was anticipating being on camera, like everybody who was in the know in academia. I saw the signs. I still don't understand the green hair, but It's a whole other story for another day. The performance can also be this slow, and that's the other point I wanted to raise. And I was creating that PDF reel for the RISD job. I just did it intuitively. I just was taking screenshots, which is, you know, a concept that I've been working through. So they were PNG files or they were PNG files, and I learned that PNG files are actually higher quality than JPEGs or PNG. They want a PDF of 20 pages. So that means there's a lot of image clarity that's lost. Well, it only really shows up in a kind of faint blurriness on the text. But when I was reviewing it, I was like, there's one image here that like, how do you read imagistically versus, I don't know, verbally? It would be like an interesting question to pursue, which is something that I've been thinking about a lot, I think, and I've just verbalized it, right? And I thought, no, I don't want this. I can't really make, I can't really say anything substantive about this. I just kept thinking, you know, if it's essentially my job talk, which it is my job talk, because I'm just going to share these images and speak about them. And I just kept thinking, when I get to this image, I'm not really going to have anything to say. And so I swapped it out. And what I put in, I was trying to find the screenshot I took of the Tina Camp, Sadia Hartman, Oakway. I can't remember exactly her last name right now, so I'm not going to say it, but, and, Simone Lee. And I thought that I had screen, and I'm sure I have them someplace, screenshots of more than one screenshot of the conversation. But it looks like I could only find one yesterday, but it was a great one. You know, it had the yellowness of the Dance Space Project, you know, website. And obviously, like, that was an influence on my embrace of yellow, I can see now, in like my living room in particular. But it had that image of Toni Morrison and a bunch of other women, Black women writers. And you could see Tina, and you could see Oakley, and you could see, and I really love that Poor People's Television. I mean, that also, really what I'm doing is curating for myself a group of artists and thinkers, right? And I'm trying to work through their work. And so I'm pausing there because that feels like the leading edge for me. Like, then what is my contribution? But I don't have to have a contribution, I think, is the answer to that. I think, yes, my contribution, of course, is not popularizing. But if I want to say disseminated after Derrida, I will say Foucault, but it's actually more of, I don't know, in some ways I see that more as a Foucauldian concept. Transmission, circulation. Right, my obligation is not to, my contribution is to circulate this work in ethical ways, not to appropriate it. And I think the fact that I'm not appropriating it and that I am circulating it in ethical ways explains a lot. 53. Like, I have been thinking about documentation and performance. What's the difference between documentation and performance? To go back to the original point or set of points I was making, autoethnography is documentation. But if you're being observed, can you ever not be performing? Right? I mean, that's a question for me. And I think that's a really live theoretical question as well. I also think that that's my contribution, right? Is, as always, to ask the next right questions, right? Speculation means asking questions. Houdini play, how did Houdini do it? Hamlet play. I have a lot of time on my hands to speculate and think. Slave play remixed. Why are we still playing with rehearsing these scripts? How do people get away with what they get away with? How do people do what they do? Why do some people, like myself, have all the time in the world to think and speculate and other people don't, right? Why are we still working out these scripts of slavery, right? And how do we stop? mean, I don't think anybody's written a book on, or even a study, perhaps, I could check on Houdini, right, as trying to escape. Wait, supremacy on some level, but is he also reenacting it, right? That's the other thing. Reenacting, I was getting, when I was looking at more and more of Simone Lee's work, right, thinking about the reenactments of mutual aid, right, in the absence of any formal assistance, right? And then thinking about the reenactments of the Civil War at Gettysburg. What are people getting out of these reenactments is the question. I understand what people are getting out of reenactments of, you know, reenactments of mutual aid. The reenactments of the Civil War have nothing to do with mutual aid. Because mutual aid was a practice that white people historically practice, which they don't, have not, then there would never have been a civil war, right? I mean, this is the whole point of Incidents in the Life of a Slave Girl to me, right? Harriet Jacobs is at every turn trying to get white women to enter the fray, enter the arena, if I could use Brené Brown's language here. Which of course reminds me of Arthur, because Brené Brown was somebody he told me about in one way that I've thought about his leave-taking is that he no longer wanted to be in the arena, but, and this is a critique of Brené Brown's work, right, which is why whiteness ultimately also, you know, brought our relationship down. Does everybody have equal opportunity to be, equal opportunity is not the correct word, phrase. Although if you think about opportunity in the way that Christina Sharp has discussed it, it is the correct phrase, right? Because in part she's turning around the concept of opportunity, right? So the normative understanding would be equal opportunity, which is understood as a hollow concept, right? Because what people want is I don't know, I'm getting lost in the weeds now. But not everybody has equal opportunity or equal access. Equal resources, perhaps. But not everybody can have equal resources or equal. I think it's the difference between equality and freedom. And that was also a conversation that Sadie and I were having. Yes, freedom has been appropriated and put to all sorts of negative, harmful, violent uses. But it's still a concept that's incredibly powerful in that that shouldn't be discarded. Whereas equality is a concept that I think should be discarded. I don't really see any redeeming aspects to that. Redeeming is also a throwback critical term that people don't tend to use so much anymore. They did. But I essentially prefigured this moment in my life in that third chapter, 103.